Not to work? Yeah. Welcome, everybody. Well, it's the first talk after the keynote speaker, Rob, from earlier. Now we've got another Rob. Well, like Ken Robinson is saying, school kills creativity. And this Rob has found a solution for it, restoring the creativity. And it's called Robot to Robot. From Robot to Robot. Rob, the floor is yours.
Right. Thank you. Can everyone hear me okay? Is that wave at the back? You can hear me. Excellent. Thank you. Hi. I'm Rob. I'm a PhD student at the University of Southampton at the moment. But in my other spare time, I work on this project called Student Robotics. And I'm going to tell you about that today. But first, I'm going to take a bit of a short detour, really to sort of justify why this kind of project is important and why I think everyone here should be thinking about getting involved in projects like this. This detour is going to involve banks somewhat weirdly. So probably everyone here is familiar with that film, hopefully. But you're probably more familiar with the term hacker and what it means. But you're probably more familiar with what it means to you and probably what it means to the media. But I've become very aware that this term means different things to different people. The hacker term has been around since sort of the 60s at least. There are various groups of people which you can associate the word hacker with, but they all have very different views and ideas. I mean, CCC probably has quite different views to the Homebrew Computer Club. I'm just looking at who came out of that, and so on. And there are loads of hacker groups around the world, you know, hacker spaces and things. But this term really means different things to different people, as I say. And to me, it means something. I think we can take all of the definitions that we see, and it really means someone who is creative with the things around them, and that's what I'm going to use it for in this talk. Just really to mean someone who is creative, but it's still kind of distinct from hobbyist and amateur in certain ways. They kind of convey that the individual doing something isn't necessarily doing it particularly well. But hacker sort of has a different vibe to it, and it has a element of community and culture and things like that. But I think, looking at this room, we're definitely, in that really small piece of this highly accurate pie chart. If you think about that pie chart as the world's population, this is grossly exaggerated as the number of hackers in our community and population. And I see this as a problem, really, because it means that we aren't always thought of when we're trying to do things and trying to work with other people. People don't really see why hacking something is good. And just think about that a bit more. Why would we want more hackers in our society? I'm sure a lot of you can answer this question, but I think one of the big problems that it solves is that creative people are good at solving problems. That's something that they do. But creative people are also good at creating problems you didn't even know you had, and that's something quite important, really. If someone solves a problem that you didn't actually realize you had, but you realize later that you did have it, then you've won quite a lot without having to do much. Which brings me to banks. As you know, banks are these fountains of paperwork that and bureaucracy, and they store our money for us. But most people think of a bank as a place in the street, and increasingly a website. And I'm talking about most people, as in the rest of the population that isn't us. They just put their money in, they'll look at the interest rate and so on, maybe, and they'll spend their money and rack up debt and credit, whatever. And they don't really see it as more than that. They kind of see the bank as a static thing. It's got all the features they need. They don't realize that it could do more, or they could do more with it. So I'm quite interested in my bank having an API so that I can work with it in a creative manner. And I think lots of you will know what an API is, an application programming interface. But just to be clear, a bank API here is something where I have my bank and I can communicate with it from a bit of software or something, probably over the internet or some network, and do stuff with my bank. All the things that I could do when I'm standing in my bank and more, you know, get events and stuff when things happen. And one of the big problems that I have when I'm trying to convey this to, you know, people who aren't in this room, is that they don't understand. Why would your bank want to have this thing? Why would you want to interact with your bank using this API? And so normally I kind of go, well, you know, it might make doing my finances a bit better, or I could find out my bank balance much more quickly. And they go, well, that sounds kind of good, but I don't really need that, and we don't need this. And to them, it's just, you know, ATM in the street, and that's it. It's very difficult. Like, well, I found it very difficult before to try and convince someone that they really wanted their bank to have an API. I mean, for example, my mum doesn't think she needs her bank to have an API, but that's because she probably wouldn't use it directly. She wouldn't use it in a program that she's written or something like that. And so until a few weeks ago, this sort of argument kind of just stopped there, really. But then I came across and these sets of wallets, which you might have seen, which are called, they're made by a guy in MIT. They're called the proverbial wallet. And this one gets harder to open the less money you have in your bank account. So it gives you the kind of idea is that it gives you a sort of tangible physical interface to your what's now more of an electronic situation. And he's got a couple of other ones as well. This one just vibrates when there's an electronic transaction that happens in your bank account. So, you know, you might develop a sense for when some dodgy stuff is happening with your money or something like that, just to give you more of an idea of when you're spending. And I think this one is the weirdest one. This one inflates the more money you have in your bank account to attract potential mates. Yeah. But to make these things, you really need to be able to interact with your bank in an electronic form, unless the bank has sold you that wallet and they've approved it. You know, you have to type in, you get your little calculator device, plug it into your wallet every time you want to know what bank balance you've got. Then you're not going to be able to buy that wallet if there's no API, or unless John Kessner gets some sort of agreement with a bank, you know, and that's going to involve a lot of paperwork, and that's probably going to stop him from doing it, from actually making these anymore. My guess is that screen scraped the bank website to actually get this data out, which isn't a sort of sustainable approach to getting an API from something. But I think that this really kind of shows that there are things that you can do with things that don't initially look like there's a space of creativity on top of them. And the people who are providing a service who say, no, we're not going to provide you with an API, we're not going to allow you to do these things, they're in their sort of box, and it's either that they can't see that how you could be creative with these things, and the other thing is that, and this is probably quite likely with the bank, they don't have enough customers asking them for an API, because they're a business and that's what they want. They want their customers to have something. So how do we solve that problem? How do we make it so that more of their customers and other businesses have an API? So the general point is that there are bits of technology which we find uses for which the manufacturer didn't, and we want shops and things to have APIs, and like I might want my plumber to have an API. Most of the interactions I have with a plumber, they're pretty regular. They're kind of, I want you to fix that tap, I want you to fix that shower and stuff. So we might be able to sort of abstract that into an API, but that's not really something that the general population is really thinking about. And so we need to think about how we can get more hackers into our society, or at least people, more awareness of hackers in our society, how we can get people to be aware that systems can be hackable, as in you can create on top of systems that are already there. And even if they need to be aware that even if they can't see a way of hacking this thing, someone else probably can. There are a lot of people in the world, and they can think of a lot of things. So, what are the reasons that we have only a really small number of hackers today? Why? So I think one of the major reasons is resources, access to tools, things like that. I think a lot of us wouldn't build a lot of the things today that we build today if we didn't have a particular tool. To a man with a hammer, everything's a nail, that kind of thing. And these projects, like RepRap, MakerBot, and Arduino, and things like that, make it easier for and cheaper. That's the essential thing here. Cheaper for people to actually get hold of resources that they can use to become creative with. And that's all well and good. And these projects are doing good work in that area. And there are loads of other projects around and things. And it's pretty much solved in software with free software. That's done. It's really beyond the software and the hardware that we have to think now, I think. And I think that we have to look in education. If you think about it, when did you become a hacker? If you think you're a hacker. And my bet is that it was after you left school. Maybe when you were at university, you started to think you were sort of a hacker, maybe, or become creative at least. And I think that this really shows that the education system itself is not doing enough to make people creative, well, help people maintain their creativity, as Ken Robinson talks about in his books. This quote really kind of sums up his ideas about, or his sort of beliefs about the education and things. And it seems to me that today, as I wrote in the abstract for this talk, the hackers are generally the people who manage